Dr. Thornberg, we have our historic $308 billion budget signed by the governor. It has been lauded by Democrats saying this is a great budget. I want to quote the pro tem here. This is part of what she said in response to the budget being signed. She says this budget is remarkable and it is responsible. So I want to take politics out of it and get your take as an economist.
Well, of course, it's a great budget. Let's be honest. It's fun spending money. We all know that, right? And of course, the state government right now is seeing this massive inflow of cash and they're spending it happily. And yeah, it allows them, if you will, the wherewithal to go and fund a whole bunch of programs which they wanted to fund. But to be clear, we have to look at these numbers. I mean, a close to $100 billion surplus, that all by itself should raise massive red flags. What you're seeing here is a state that is running on a temporary lift, if you will, provided, of course, from the over-the-top federal stimulus that's been put in place over the last 2 years. In fact, the entire economy, stock markets, housing, the state budget, everything has been massively inflated. And the big problem here, of course, is what goes up must come down. In other words, these revenues are certainly here today, but history tells us very clearly they're not going to be there tomorrow, and nobody in Sacramento was talking about that day of reckoning.
All right, so let's talk about a piece that you wrote prior to the budget being signed where you sort of outline where we've been in California economically in the past. It's titled, After the Surplus, Buckle Up for the Deficit. And I want to start with the last line of your piece, and then we can work our way up. It is, again, buckle up. It's going to be a rough few years. I mean, what do you want Californians to know? I mean, what's alarming to you? I know you just laid out a couple of things there.
Right. So to be clear, our budget in California, our state budget, is heavily funded through personal income taxes, which, of course, because of our progressive income tax system in the state, means it's heavily weighted on the incomes of high-end earners. Now, listen, I'm all for soak the rich and all that kind of good stuff, but we also have to remember that you build in dangerous cyclical components into our state revenues. When things are good, when the economy's heating up, when the asset markets are going crazy, there's tons of capital gains flowing into, of course, rich California citizens' coffers, and they in turn give a bunch of that back to the state in the form of personal income taxes. But the history of this is very clear. How many times in the last two decades have we seen this cycle of a huge increase in asset prices, followed by, of course, a collapse in asset prices? Because the kind of surge we're seeing in asset prices is clearly not sustainable from a trend or even a level perspective. Now, if you look back at this, late 90s, the dot-com situation, the run-up to the Great Recession, huge asset bubbles left us huge surpluses, and immediately afterwards, we saw $20, $30, $40 billion budget deficits because all those capital gains, which had fueled the huge surplus, disappeared, leaving a massive gap in its wake. It's the same story. What's most amazing to me about all this happiness in Sacramento is how they're ignoring history. Does no one else remember Gray Davis being thrown out of office because of the anger of the electorate? Does no one else remember John Chung paying state vendors with IOUs because the state had run out of money? We're going right there again, and nobody in Sacramento is even talking about it. The rainy day fund is pathetic. It's nowhere near the kind of coverage we need. And so yeah, buckle up. All this wonderful time is going to be followed by some severe belt tightening. And boy, local governments, various sorts of nonprofits, all the folks out there who rely on the largesse of the state better be prepared.
Or we just need the richest Californians continuing to keep getting richer. I'm saying that tongue in cheek there. I just want to ask you though, if you could, obviously Governor Newsom has numerous economic advisors, but if you could get into the room with him and give him some advice, what would you say to him?
Well, right off the bat, he has economic advisors that are saying the same thing I am. If you listen to the LAO, they put out similar warnings. That, of course, is the nonpartisan analyst office for really everybody in public government. Again, he's saying this is not sustainable. You shouldn't be doing this. You need to have a bigger rainy day fund. And they're just completely ignoring him. I would, of course, be making the same message. But again, remember, nothing, no one in politics is rewarded for forward thinking, right? Not now. Holding money back would almost assuredly incur the wrath of the voter. And that basic reality is driving the show in Sacramento. Look, politicians, like it or not, are a reflection of us because we elect them, we choose them, we follow them. And if they're ignoring what's coming down the pike, it's because we're ignoring it. So we better wake up.
Dr. Chris Thornberg, we thank you for your time and analysis once again here on Inside California Politics.
My pleasure.